Srimati N. Kritika Lakshmi, currently working as Associate Professor in Satyabhama University, Chennai. She has done her Bachelor of Architecture from Periyar Maniammai College of Technology for Women, Bharathidasan University, Trichy, and Postgraduate Diploma in Business Administration from ICFAI University, Hyderabad. She has also done Master of Architecture in Building Management from Satyabhama University, Chennai. She has been involving in developing and delivering lectures for undergraduates and postgraduate students using innovative teaching practices. She has attended several conferences and have made presentations in specialized subject area in architecture.
Welcome to UGC lecture series for Bachelor of Architecture on the subject Building Services. This is about water supply and sanitation. And in this lecture, we'll be looking into rainwater harvesting and wastewater treatment methods. The contents of this thing are rainwater harvesting, components of rainwater harvesting, different methods of rainwater harvesting, wastewater treatment, and mandatory plumbing arrangement in apartment buildings. I have covered Chennai Metropolitan Development Authority's mandatory plumbing arrangement. Now, rainwater harvesting. What is rainwater harvesting really? It is like harvesting of rainwater is like it's a technique basically where we collect the water from surfaces where the rain falls, and it is stored for later use. So, why is this important? The rainwater harvesting is needed to improve the water supply, the food production, and ultimately you get the food security. Generally, it contributes to the income generation also. Water insecure households or individuals in rural areas, they will be benefiting the most. Providing a household with high quality drinking water and year round storage. So many benefits are obtained when you harvest rainwater. So, it is really a very important phenomena to be followed. So, there are many methods to do rainwater harvesting. Broadly, we look into two areas. First is the surface runoff harvesting, and then the rooftop rainwater. In urban areas, we have a huge surface areas. We don't have permeable lands. We have concrete surfaces. So, the rain that falls in that, it runs away as surface runoff. So, how you can this water can be caught and it can be used in aquifers and by using adopted appropriate methods, and then you can save those water. In rooftop rainwater harvesting, that is what everybody does, where the roof will become the catchment area and the water is collected and then it is taken down to the ground aquifers. Now, this is basically how a rainwater harvesting works. So, in this picture, if you can see, so you have the roof. This is the catchment area where you collect the water, and you have a gutter. So, the water flows from the roof to the gutter, and from there it is collected in a pipe. This is the downtake pipe where the collected water flows down, and here you have a storage where it can be collected directly to the storage, and then you have a delivery pipelines, and then it goes to the first flush and then a filter. We'll be looking about all these components in detail. So, this is basically how a rainwater harvesting is done for a rooftop. So, we'll see each one in detail. So, catchment, the surface where it receives the rainfall, that area we call it as the catchment. So, it can be a terrace, it can be a courtyard, it can be a paved surface or any open ground. So, the terrace will be generally made of flat RCC or stone roof or sloping roof. So, this is the area which actually contributes to for harvesting the rainwater. Then transportation. So, from the catchment area, the water will flow down from the rooftop, the rainwater from rooftop, it should be carried to the storage system. So, it is carried through downtake water pipes or drains to the store system. These water pipes should be UV resistant with the required capacity depending on the rainfall in a particular area. The water from sloping roofs could be caught through gutters and takedown pipes. If it is a sloping roof, you need to have gutters to catch the water. At terraces, the mouth of each drain should have a wire mesh so that there is any other floating material, foreign object can be captured there itself. It will not come to the storage area. Then first flush. So, it is a device which is to flush off the water received in the first shower, because the water from the first shower, it will be contaminated. It will carry all the dirt from the terrace and even the dirt from the air. This needs to be done to avoid contaminating the storage or rechargeable water. It helps to cleaning of silt and other material deposited on the roof during dry season. So, in dry seasons, so many dirt will get collected on the roof. So, to filter that, we use this first flush. So, provisions of first rain separator should be made an outlet to each drain pipe. So, the first shower that is coming into, it should not be taken into the storage. You have to make a separator so that it will be drained out. Then is the filter. Filters are used for treatment of water to effectively remove turbidity, color and microorganisms. So, after flushing the thing, it should pass through filters. So, the filters will be like a gravel, sand and netlon mesh filter is designed. So, that is placed on top of the storage tank and the water will pass through it. So, the water is filtered. So, the storage tank will be clean always. And storage tanks. So, these tanks can be above the ground or below the ground. So, the water collected, it is diverted to a storage tank or it is recharged to the underground aquifers. So, when you divert it to a storage tank, it can be used for secondary purpose like washing, gardening, like that you can use the water. But when we recharge the groundwater also, percolation will happen in the ground and the groundwater table will improve. Now, when you come to the delivery systems, the piping system that is going to convey the stored rainwater till the end use is called the delivery system in rainwater harvesting. So, these are the components. So, what are the various methods you recharge the groundwater aquifers? So, you can recharge the bore wells, recharge the dug wells, recharge pits can be done, recharge shafts are done, recharge trenches are usually made. This is for the surface runoff and you have a percolation tank. So, we will see each one in detail here. So, recharging of bore wells, the water that we collect, it is diverted to the bore wells after passing through a sedimentation or filtration tank, settlement tank. So, if you see here, this is the filtration tank, you have the, this is a bore well. So, the water will come inside, here you have the filter, it will pass through all the sand, the charcoal, the gravel and the pebbles are there. So, the water will pass all through these filters and come here. So, here you have the collection tank and this will again, this is a settlement tank. So, whatever, even if something comes through these filters, it settles here and then it is charged to the bore well. Now, recharging of dug wells. So, when you have dug wells, how we have to do it? So, after passing through the filtration bed we saw here, the same thing it is here. So, passing through the surface filters, it comes down and the dug well will be recharged. So, this is how you recharge a dug well. So, all around the well, you will have the filtering, filter beds. There you have the perforated pipes to collect the water and charge the, recharge the dug well. The next is the recharge pits. So, this is what is generally done where you do not have a bore well or a dug well, you go for a recharge pit. So, it is a small pit, it will have a, it is rectangular or square or also circular. It will be 1 to 2 meters in width and 2 to 3 meters in depth. So, it is constructed with brick and stone with a weep hole. So, this is your RCC slab, this is your floor level. Then you have your perforated brickwork here. So, the water comes in through this and here you have your filter bed where the things will be filtered and the pit is recharged. Then the similar thing, you have recharge shafts. Here the size is different. The bored hole will be there with 30 meter diameter and it is 10 to 15 meters deep. So, if you have to go too much depth is needed, you go for a shaft where the width will be less and the depth will be more. The same filter bed can be seen here. So, this bore again, it has to be lined with slotted or perforated PVC. So, the bore that you see here, this will be again, it will not be just a shaft, it will be lined, means there will be an inner pipe put inside and that will have slotted pipe. So, the water will go to the water table. Next, you have recharge trenches. Usually, it is made for surface runoff. If you see here, it is a trench of size 0.5 to 1 meter wide and the depth will be 1 to 2 meter. So, this is your perforated cover. So, the surface water will go into perforated, the holes will be there on top of the cover. So, the holes will go inside this, then you have the filter media and these trenches will collect the water. So, it is excavated on ground and refilled with the porous media like pebbles, boulders or brick beds. Then the same thing, the trenches, when it is a tank, it is called a percolation tank. This is artificially created surface water bodies like a lake or ponds, water bodies will be created and this will be a slight depth to your normal floor area and that will have the percolation will happen there. So, all the surface runoff will be, water will be diverted to that tank and then water is collected there. So, these are the various methods you can recharge groundwater aquifers. Now, the other water that we use, how you can reuse it or how you can conserve it. So, that is wastewater treatment. So, what is wastewater? Wastewater is water no longer needed or suitable for its most recent use. You cannot use it immediately or you do not need that water anymore. That water we call it as wastewater. So, how do you treatment? Treatment means you remove the impurities from the water being the treated. So, put together is your wastewater treatment. When the water which is no longer needed, you remove the impurities and so that it can be reused, that is wastewater treatment. So, it is a process to convert wastewater into effluent which can be reused or returned to the water cycle with minimal environmental issues. So, when it comes to wastewater, we have to consider this. Minimal environmental issues. So, this wastewater can be directly reused, that is called reclamation, water reclamation. So, avoiding the disposal of the use of treated water effluent can be for various purposes this is used. The physical infrastructure used for this kind of a treatment is called WWTP, that is wastewater treatment plant. In short, we call it as WWTP. So, why we have to treat wastewater? What is the real need for it? The used water what we have, why we have to treat it? Why not we use it directly? Because they have different types of impurities. We have human waste, food scraps, oil, soaps, chemicals, so much impurities are there in the used water. If you do not treat the water or you use it directly, then the environment and human health can be affected, negatively impacted. So, what are the impacts? If the water, when you directly leave it into the water bodies or something, it will harm fish and the wildlife population. It will deplete the oxygen, the chemicals in the used water. It will consume the oxygen in the water and it will deplete the oxygen. Beach closures will happen. Other restrictions on recreational water use, restrictions on fish and shellfish harvesting and contamination of drinking water. So, when you do not treat the water, wastewater and you can use it or throw it away directly, so there is so many problems coming up. So, the main objective of wastewater treatment is to remove as much of the suspended solids as possible before the remaining water which we call it as effluent, which is discharged back to the environment. So, what are the objectives? You have to kill the pathogens first. Then remove the quality of improve the quality of wastewater. You avoid unhygienic conditions, protect the aquatic life from the toxicity waste. As I told you, it is harmful for the fish, the chemicals in the used water. To make the wastewater usable for agricultural or aquaculture, so that you do not waste the water, you actually reuse it. So, what is the process? So, wastewater treatment, it is done in three stages like physical, chemical and biological method. Three ways you do it and three processes there. It is classified broadly like primary treatment, secondary treatment and tertiary treatment. What is the primary treatment? In primary treatment, what we do here is, if you look at this picture, you will understand. It is collected and you have a grit chamber and a sedimentation tank. It is just left to settle here. So, what happens is large suspended floating solids will be removed from this process. So, more complex compounds are broken up and it is converted to simpler compounds so that decomposition can happen. So, here you have screens, grit chambers and primary sedimentation tanks. So this is your screens, that is filters. Screens are nothing but filters. So huge undissolved solids will be filtered here. Then you have the grit chamber where the smaller things will be settled here, and again you have sedimentation tank for very finer particles to settle at the bottom of the tank. The next process here, secondary treatment. Here what happens is we add biological, this is the biological treatment where you add certain things so that you, the remaining organic matter will be removed, like it will decompose easily. So this is your primary, from the primary clarifier, that is your primary treatment process. From here it is taken to the aeration tank. Here you have a compressor where water, air is sent into this water and aeration will take place. So more oxygen will be given to the air, and then it goes to the secondary clarifier, and whatever is sedimented here, again it comes here for aeration. So it is a cyclic process. So this is like consists of biological treatment units. It has secondary settling tank, secondary clarifier and sludge digester. Now tertiary treatment. In this tertiary treatment, the non-biodegradable, so whatever you cannot decompose in the secondary treatment, that will be taken care of in your tertiary treatment by chemical process. Here non-biodegradable organic pollutant and a significant percentage of nutrients like nitrogen and phosphorus will be removed. This nitrogen and phosphorus are very harmful to your aquatic life or wildlife. So it's an advanced treatment. This is used for wastewater from industry, specifically containing specific pollutions. Like industries, we have so many chemical wastewater coming out. So for that particular wastewater, we use the tertiary treatment. So this is about the process, treatment process. So we are going to look into the waste management for water. This waste management is made mandatory by governing authorities or the planning authorities, development authorities. Here we will be looking into Chennai Metropolitan Development Authority's mandatory requirements. In residential or predominantly residential developments, when you have dwelling units, more than 100 dwelling units are there, then you should have a waste management infrastructure. Below that, it is not mandatory. But when the dwelling units exceed 100 in number, you should have a waste management infrastructure. This will be applicable for apartments basically, where you have a large complex of apartments. So the dwelling units, when it goes beyond 100, you will have a waste management infrastructure. At least a closed non-polluting storage provision should be there for solid waste storage within the premises itself. So, even if you don't have a huge infrastructure, a huge treatment plant, you should have at least a closed non-polluting storage provision should be there. So that temporarily when you store there, the sedimentation, at least the primary treatment at least will happen there, and then the waste can be taken out. So, these infrastructure, waste management infrastructure or whatever you are providing there, should have direct access from the abutting road so that the local body can remove the stored water from the storage. Then that is about wastewater. When it comes to sanitation, when you talk about sewage system, you should have when the local body is not providing any sewage system. So what you do is, if the dwelling units exceeds 50 numbers or the area is more than 2500 square meter, you should have a sewage treatment plant. So it shall be provided and maintained by the people who live there, and the disposal of the sewage will happen within the site itself. So for all these things, you should have proper clearance from the city water supply and pollution control board, and the location and design has to happen accordingly. Now when the dwelling units is less than 50 and there is no sewage line provided by the city corporation and the area is less than 2500 square meter, then you can have a septic tank with upflow filter. So this is what a septic tank with the upflow filter is. That should also be within the premises, and then disposal of the sewage also will happen within the site itself. And now coming to rainwater harvesting. So the mandatory provisions for special buildings, group developments and multi-story buildings that is given is, there should be a pebble bed of 1 meter wide and 1.5 meter depth. We saw the recharging of aquifers, right? So the same similar kind of thing has to be given. What is the size of this? Everything is given in the thing. There should be minimum of 1 meter width and 1.5 meter depth all around the building. You should have this, and then it should be filled with round pebbles. The size of the pebbles is 5 centimeters and 7.5 centimeter size. So you have to provide this kind of an arrangement for special buildings, group buildings and multi-story buildings. Special buildings, with any building with more than 4 stories is considered as special buildings. Group buildings will be this special buildings when you have more than one in number within one complex, that is called group development or group buildings. And then multi-story building is floors more than 4 floors, that is called multi-story buildings. So these kind of buildings, it is mandatory to have a rainwater harvesting all around the building. Concrete paving should be done for these buildings, should be done all around the building, and the slope should be 1:20, and the slope should be towards the pebble bed that has already been done. So the rainwater from the terrace and the pavement will flow to this pebble bed, flow towards the pebble bed all around. So that is why we are providing this all around the building. So whichever direction the rainwater flows, it will reach the pebble bed. Then draft walls in masonry of 7.5 centimeters. Draft wall is, it's like a speed breaker. Okay, that will be provided at the entrance, because when you dig this trench all around the building, you have entrance and exit. One entrance and one exit will be mandatory, will be there. So there you cannot have this, you have the trench, and above that you will have a draft wall. You do it in masonry. It should be at least 7.5 centimeters. Height will be like at the entrance, depending on the entrance height. And the other thing is, this will also stop the rainwater from going into the road from the entrance and exits. And then there are additional regulations for all buildings that has been given is, in the, if you have ground floor, the floor level of the closets should be at least 0.9 meter from the road level. You cannot have it less than that. And centrally air conditioned buildings should have their own wastewater reclamation plant. Wastewater reclamation is the cooling towers, the water that whichever is coming out can be again used for the cooling thing itself. So for cooling purposes, and use reclaimed wastewater for cooling purposes. And the additional regulation, another thing is, separate some should be constructed for potable water supplied by the city water, and the volume should not exceed 1000 liters per dwelling. So this sump will be independent of other tanks, so that storing water from other sources will be done here. Other sources, in the sense, the rainwater harvesting water can be stored here. So that should not be less than 1000 liters for a dwelling. So a separate sump also is needed. So this is about wastewater conservation. So here in this lecture, what we understood is, like, we understood what is rainwater harvesting and what is the need for doing rainwater harvesting, what are the different types in that, and the various methods to recharge the underground aquifers. And again, we came to wastewater treatment, what is the meaning of it, and why you need to do a treatment, and the different process involved in wastewater treatment. And finally, we saw what are the mandatory regulations for conserving water proposed by Chennai Metropolitan Development Authority for wastewater treatment and rainwater harvesting. So the probable questions for this part of the lecture will be like, what do you mean by rainwater harvesting? Describe the different ways rainwater can be harvested. Explain various methods of recharging the groundwater. What is wastewater treatment? Why do we have to do it? That is the need for it. You explain the process of wastewater treatment, and you write about the mandatory provisions for water conservation. So with this, we conclude this lecture, and we'll see in the next. Thank you.